Whenever you snap your fingers, clap your hands in rhythm, or predict when to catch an object in the air, you're using me. You could imagine how important I am for playing tennis, driving a car, in tight traffic, or chasing a prey in the forest. Hi, I'm cerebellum, which roughly translates to little brain. Throughout the history, the Greeks have called me by other names, cerebrum parvum, encephalium, and cranium, cerebrum posterius, and paraencephalis. It makes sense, since Greeks like Aristotle and Herophilus were the first to recognize my existence. Later on, in Renaissance, Vesalius drew a picture of me, said some words in 1543, and then Thomas Willis, you know, the guy who discovered the circle of Willis in the brain, took more time to get to know me in 1664. Later on in 1809, Luigi Rolando, you know, the guy from Central Solstice, the Fisher of Rolando, found out that if I get hurt, then you move weird. Then later, some experiments were carried out in animals, and that they could move even if I was wrecked, but without coordination. I coordinate what comes from your senses and what you do with your muscles. I'm located right here beneath the hemispheres and above the medulla oblongata. Even though I occupy just 10% of the total brain, my real estate is equal to 60% of the big brain. And how about half of all your neurons in your head? How about that? All densely packed and organized in my two halves, or hemispheres, if you will, united in the middle by a vermis, or worm. My hemispheres has a cortex of gray matter and a deeper cortex of white matter. If you got me in half, you see my surface looks like leaves. There are three layers in my cortex: the molecular or synaptic, the Purkinje layer or discharge layer, and the granular or receptive layer. I'm connected to the spinal cord, brainstem, and cerebral hemispheres by three major fiber tracts: cerebellar peduncles, which bring in information to me in afferent fashion, or away from me in efferent fashion. Until 1970s, no one knew what I was doing in the skull. What was my function, they wondered. Was I there just for muscle surveillance duty? I mean, come on. However, people with damage in their cerebellum can't quite coordinate their movements and move without precision, which can make it difficult to stand and cause some shaking. But not just that. If I'm not working properly, you may have trouble with senses, talking, feelings, and others. Not exactly motor functions per se. I'm very active when you use your fingers to compare textures between two objects, using your fingertips, when someone touches your lips, and when you're navigating spaces. If you have damage in your cerebellum, you can't tell which size of a 3D object belongs to the same object, if anything. Your ears and the way you listen to words that sound similar but are different has something to do with me as well. In those with damage, they probably can't tell the difference between work and woke because they sound the same to them. It is said that there are some components of audition that are part of my duties, but they're just recently being studied and aren't understood quite well. As the time passes and you become older, I change, not necessarily at the same pace as the rest of your brain. In a human being who's about 100 years old, I would be probably 15 years younger based on epigenetics, biomarkers in my tissue. If you look at the gene expression patterns in me, they would show less age-related alterations than in the rest of the brain. Even though some studies may say that there are reduced number of cells, but none of that is confirmed, so just so you know, I stay young. I know all this information is a pain in the ass, but did you know that I'm also involved in your pain? Yes, I receive the pain information from many parts of the brain, which is then used to make you remember that you shouldn't put your hands in that hot pot because it's hot and it's gonna hurt, and that you shouldn't put the tail of your cat because it will bite you and it will hurt. So next time, you'll avoid repeating actions that led to painful experiences, which are graded according to pain intensity and whatnot. This can also lead to changes in posture when a part of your body hurts and you're trying to avoid that posture because you don't want any pain, of course.